remain with us in thy presence, the fullness of joy in his presence.
Let your kingdom shine upon this earth. living, glorious church, not for temporary deeds, but to restore authority and power. Let a mighty rushing wind blow in, touch your people once again. Let a mighty rushing wind blow.
Thank you so much, Martha. Would you take your Bibles this morning and turn to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. And when we get to Philippians chapter 1, we are going to read beginning at verse 12. Well, last week the Lord graced me with the privilege of preaching here in the morning and then again that night. And I thank Him for the privilege that He's given me to preach today. Philippians chapter 1, beginning at verse 12. I'll be reading from the New International Version. Someone asked me one time, I've been preaching now this Bible and reading this Bible since 1984. Cindy bought it as a gift to me. And I own about 14 different Bibles, and they're in my study in the barn. And somebody asked me, Brother Mike, what's the best Bible to read? I say the one you got at home. You read it, and there's enough in there to keep you busy and straight from now on. Amen. All right, let's read Philippians 1, beginning at verse 12. A lot of verses. We'll preach them all, okay? Now, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. Because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so in love, knowing I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached, and because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help given me by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. Verse 20, I eagerly expect and hoped that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. Now, of all those verses, probably the best known is verse 21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I want to preach to you today on this subject, when Christ is your life. The background of this is that Paul is in prison at Rome and he is awaiting a capital trial. Because of God's presence in his life now, he is a very good man whose life is in the hands of a very bad man, the emperor of Rome. And when he writes to the Philippians, he has not seen them in 10 years. They've heard of his arrest. They love him. They're concerned about him. They're nervous and anxious about what's going to happen to him. So they send a man to see him and help him. And with the man they send an offering so that the man can buy things that Paul might need while he is a prisoner. Well, Paul knows and writes to the Philippians. He will send the letter to the Philippians back with the man who's come to see him and help him. He knows that the situation is going to turn out in one of two ways. Either he's going to be put to death, or he's going to be allowed to go on living. And if he goes on living, he says he's going to go on ministering. But whatever the outcome, life or death, Paul wants the Philippian Christians to know how he felt about it. So he says this, living is Christ, dying is gain. With Jesus, it's heads I win, tails I win. That's what he's saying here. Now I want to speak to you this morning on this subject. He says that Christ was his life. I want to show you from the verses we read things that the Word of God teaches us about Christ being your life. Now we would say, most of us would say, Jesus is my life. We're going to find out. Now notice this, that Paul does not say that his life was the church, even though he loved churches, founded churches, established churches, pastored churches, checked on churches, wrote to churches, encouraged churches, and sometimes corrected churches. His life was involved in church stuff. But he never said, my life is in the church. He didn't say that his life was in the ministry. Though he was the pastor of all pastors, he was the teacher of all teachers, he was the theologian of all theologians, he was the scholar of all scholars, the missionary of all missionaries. He never says that his life was in ministry. He says this, his life was in Christ. Now let me show you three things from the text about that. Are you interested today? We're going to load your wagon up, all right? Number one, write this down, you're going to need it. When Christ is your life, it will transform your disappointments. Did you get it? Did you hear it? Look back at verse 12. Now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. What had happened to him? He'd become a prisoner. He'd gone to jail. Things have not turned out like Paul thought they would. Things have not turned out like Paul planned that they would. If we were to go back to Romans chapter 15, now understand that Philippi is a Roman colony. All right? In Romans chapter 15, verses 23 through 24, Paul had written to the Romans these words, "I have been longing for many years to come and see you." He said, "I plan to do so when I go to Spain. I hope to visit you while passing through and have you assist me on my journey." Now, Paul had written to these Christians in Rome saying, "I'm going to Spain to share Christ. I'm going to Spain to share the gospel. I'm going to Spain as a missionary, but on my way there, I'm going to stop and fellowship with you. We're going to spend some time together, and we're going to love each other. And I hope I can be a help to you, and you can be a help to me on my mission trip to Spain." Now watch this. In Philippians 1, now watch, Paul would go to Rome. But his aspiration had turned into incarceration because he went to Rome as a prisoner. He went to Rome in chains, planning to go as a free man on a mission trip to go to Spain and share the gospel. But watch this, it didn't turn out that way. He ends up under arrest and he's put on a ship to Rome, but not as a preacher, as a prisoner. If that's not bad enough, the ship, 276 people on board, the ship gets caught in a storm, and for 14 days, they can't tell if it's day or night. That's the severity of the storm. The ship on which Paul was a prisoner with other prisoners, the ship breaks apart, and everyone on it finds themselves in the water. So they're holding on to pieces of the ship that had broken apart, and they make their way to an island. No one drowned, no one died. When they get to this island, they're soaking wet and cold, so they began to gather wood for a fire. Remember that? As they gather wood for a fire, Paul picks up a bundle and there's a snake in it, poisonous, and it bites him. He shakes it off into the fire. It kills him. But God, listen to me, wouldn't let him die because God had a plan, watch, and it was for him to go to Rome. But he wasn't getting to go like he wanted to. He wasn't getting to go like he thought he would. 3 months later, after the shipwreck, he and the prisoners are on another ship and they sail to Rome. Paul is not there to fellowship with the believers like he planned to. He's not there now to take an offering and head to Spain with the gospel. He's there as a prisoner. And look what he says in verse 12. What has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. What was he going to do in Spain? Advance the gospel. But he doesn't get to go. But God uses him to advance the gospel in Rome as a prisoner. Now, folks, his plans did not reach fruition. His dreams were crushed. But when Christ is your life, it transforms your disappointments. Because you understand that the steps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord. And God is sovereign. And God is in control. And look what happens in verse 13. As a result. Result of what? Him being in Rome in chains. As a result, it has become clear, now look at this, throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else, that I am in chains for Christ. See the phrase, the whole palace guard. We can equate that to this, the Roman secret service. The palace guard guarded the emperor of Rome. They guarded the emperor's family. And they guarded the emperor's prisoners. Had Paul gone to Rome to fellowship, he'd have never had access to the Roman secret service. No one in the palace of the emperor would have known anything about him at that time. Now listen to me. But now, men that he would never have been able to get close to, he's chained to one of them for hours every day. He writes, watch this. What has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. But notice that it wasn't just the palace guard that heard the gospel because of Paul's chains. Look at verse 13. He says, and to everyone else. People all over Rome. Because he's a prisoner. Chained to the palace guard. Watch this. People all over Rome are talking about the prisoner named Paul. He claimed to know for a fact that Jesus of Nazareth had been crucified. He claimed to have seen him. In resurrection power. Now, folks, why have I said all that? When Jesus is your life, I got news for you. Things aren't always going to work out in your life like you think they would, like you hope they would, like you planned they would. But it transforms your disappointments. Because of this, you are God's, and he is in absolute total control of everything in your life. Now watch this. They say that a novice chess player thinks three moves ahead. A master chess player, Bobby Fischer, remember him? Thinks 30 moves ahead. Now let me ask you a question. How many moves ahead in your life does God see and know? Whew. Not three. And not 30. All of them. Prime rib today, folks, I'm telling you. Watch this. God is way ahead of us. And God was way ahead of Paul. What may have first been a disappointment to Paul, because he wants to go to Spain, stop off at Rome on the way, and now he's arrested and in chains. Don't you know he was disappointed? He's facing capital punishment, death. Well, the gospel won't be advanced in Spain if he's dead. But before that, God wanted the gospel advanced in Rome. Now watch. When Christ is your life, it transforms your disappointments. January the 1st, 1990, Cindy and I left our hometown and our home church and went to be on staff at a church in Arnold, Missouri, which is right out of South County, 15 miles straight south of the Arch. We were there for 8.5 years, and then we left there and went to Centralia and pastored there for 7 years. And then two separate search committees pursued us to come back to West Frankfort. Wasn't God's will when the first committee did. Second time, we felt that it was. But when we came back to West Frankfort, I had a plan. I had a dream. I had this vision of preaching the gospel to thousands of people in my hometown as the pastor of the First Baptist Church. That was my plan. Well, I want you to know something. I got to do it, but not the way I planned. You see, I didn't get to preach to the people of West Frankfort through auditoriums jam-packed with people and large worship services. But over the last 18 years, I have conducted hundreds, no exaggeration, more than 200 funerals at West Frankfort. And for some of those funerals, there might be a handful of folks. And for some of those funerals, there were auditoriums full of people. But God allowed me to preach the gospel to thousands of people in West Frankfort, but not the way I planned and not the way I wanted. When we were at the church in St. Louis, the governor of Missouri was John Ashcroft. John Ashcroft is a born-again believer, a devoted man of God. He's an outstanding Christian and several times came to our church and he played the piano and sang. But after his time as the governor of Missouri was over, a Senate seat came open. And he was very popular as a governor and he believed that God wanted him to be a senator from Missouri. Most thought he was a shoo-in. At election time, he lost. He was disappointed. He was crushed. The way that he thought God would use him was not at all the way God was going to use him because he didn't get elected to the Senate. But at the next presidential election, you see, he was an attorney, and the President of the United States named him the Attorney General of the United States of America. Now, why have I said all that? Listen to me. He was disappointed, but he didn't know that God was way ahead of him. That God had other plans. That God was sovereign. So when Christ is your life, it's going to disappoint. It's going to change or transform disappointments. You had plans. You had dreams. I prayed for my children for years. For years. That they would be preachers and missionaries and church staff folks. None of them are. It wasn't. But you know what? Hey, that's what I wanted. That's what my dreams were. But you know what? Hey, I understand this. God is in control. Are you with me? You want any more? All right. When Christ is your life, it will transform your disappointments. Things aren't going to turn out a lot of times like you want them to. Hoped they would. Prayed they would. But you understand, God is in control. Now that's cliche-ish, isn't it? Folks, let me tell you about it. Say something about that. God is in control. And while this world may look like it's out of control, don't you kid yourself. History is His story. God's in control. Oh, Brother Mike, what about all that's going on in the Middle East? God is in control. Number two. Not only when Christ is your life will it transform your disappointments, when Christ is your life, it will change your relationships. Look at verses 15, 16, and 17. It's true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. Now, while Paul is in chains, some men are trying to stir up trouble for him, and they are preachers. Oh my goodness. Now, the understatement would be, Paul doesn't need any more trouble at this time. Remember, he's facing a capital trial that will cost him his life. And the devil gives him trouble, and the Jews gave him trouble, and the emperor of Rome could give him big trouble. And add to that, some men who preach are stirring up trouble. For Paul, irritating people. Folks, don't we have enough trouble in our lives without people who call themselves Christians adding to it? Don't we have enough trouble without folks in the church? Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, we sing, but I'm not speaking to that guy over there. Really? Now notice this. Paul's saying, hey, that guy's giving me trouble. Big trouble. They're adding to trouble I don't need. But notice what he says in verse 18. This is incredible. But what does it matter? The important thing that is that in every way, whether from false preachers or true, Christ is preached. Wow. And because of this I rejoice and I will continue to rejoice. Now Now he's got troublemakers, critics, betrayers in his life. He could have eaten them alive in the letter. But he doesn't focus on them. He said, what's it matter what they do to me? What's the matter? It don't matter. All I care about, he says, is that Jesus gets lifted up. Wow! All I care about is that Christ be glorified. And folks, when Christ is your life, it will transform your relationships, even the bad ones. Because it's not going to be about you getting even, or you getting ahead, or you putting them in their place. What's going to matter is what? Is that, say what you want about me. Do what you want to me. All I care about is lifting up Jesus and glorifying Him. Now, I had some things I wanted to say about that, but we're not going to go any farther with that. When Christ is your life, it's going to transform your disappointments and it's going to transform your relationships. There was a pilot who climbed into the cockpit of a jet, and the jet was equipped with the latest technology and weaponry. The jet could fly at supersonic speeds and had the capabilities of destroying enemies miles and miles away. But as he reaches a cruising altitude, the pilot takes off his helmet and relaxes, just cruising along. With his helmet off, he hears a strange scratching noise coming from the instrument panel. To his horror, he sees a stowaway rat, and it's chewing on the wires of the instrument panel. He's too far to return to the base, and the rat is out of reach. He can't kill it. If he doesn't do something, the plane will, or the jet will crash. So here's what he did. He went straight up. He went straight up to an altitude where the rat could not live. He went up to a level where a rat could not survive. Because at that level, he had oxygen mask. Folks, we all got rats in our lives. And they're going to gnaw at us. And if we let them bring us down, they will bring us down. But when Christ is your life, here's how you handle the rats. Head up. Up to a higher level. The rats can't survive there. Paul said it didn't matter to him what the rats did. My reputation's not my life. My ministry's not my life. Jesus is my life. When Christ is your life, and people wrong you, and we've all been wronged, and they betray you, and we've all been betrayed, and they hurt you, and we've all been hurt. It's not going to be about getting back or getting even, because that won't glorify Christ. Number three. When Christ is your life, you can face life's uncertainties. Look at verses 22 and 23. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. Paul doesn't know how things are going to turn out. He's facing uncertainties. He didn't know as a prisoner if he's going to be allowed to live or if he's going to be put to death. But because Christ was his life, watch this, it didn't matter what happened to him. He wins. If I go on living, it means fruitful ministry. He said, but I desire to depart and be with Christ. That word depart in the original pictured a ship weighing anchor and sailing to a faraway land. It pictured a soldier taking down a tent. The war was over. The battle had been fought. And he's trading in the tent for a permanent dwelling place. Watch this. Because Christ was his life, he said, I can take it. Because, here we go again, with Jesus it's heads I win, tails I win. How about it, folks? Well, when Christ is your life, it'll transform your disappointments. Things may not turn out like you wanted, but God's in control. It changes your relationships. Folks may not treat you right. They may wrong you, but you can't be caught up or consumed with wronging them. Your concern has got to be that Jesus be lifted up. And when Christ is your life, no matter what, you can face life's uncertainties. Because with Jesus, you win no matter what. What a Savior. That's all I got. Let's stand to our feet.